Well, it was quite an education, to say the least. A college junior tells police that she was raped. They declined to press charges. She files a complaint with campus cops and gets checked out by school doctors. And then she says she was urged to go away, to drop the complaint and pick up with her studies. Catherine Russell is the face of a case that became a much wider investigation by the Center for Public Integrity. And the group found this is not an isolated outrage. Here's some stats. According to the Justice Department, 1 in 5 women on college campuses will become a victim of rape or attempted rape. And about 95% remain silent, never even reporting the crime. Joining us from New York, Paul Callan, a defense attorney and former prosecutor, and also Kristen Lombardi. She's the investigative reporter who dug into all of this for the Center for Public Integrity. And I got to tell you, Kristen, great job. We were pretty amazed by this story and, of course, want to talk to you more about it. We just set up Catherine's story, Catherine Russell, and what she says happened to her. But she wasn't alone. What shocked you the most as you investigated this story for 9 months?
Thank you, Kara, for having me on. I think one of the things that shocked us the most about this is just, you know, the level of underreporting that goes on about this this problem. I mean, we found overwhelmingly many students don't report simply because they don't identify what happened to them as sexual assault. And to me, that was pretty striking. But when they do report, even if it's delayed and it's late reporting, we found that institutional obstacles really compound the problem. For instance, a lot of the students that we interviewed described situations where administrators discouraged them from pursuing rape complaints within the college judicial system. They actively, you know, discouraged them by presenting the on-campus judicial process as, you know, a really unappealing, unattractive process, something that they were going to beat their heads against the wall with. And so students often just said, why bother? Why go forward? And then for students who actually did go through a judicial process, they really described a process that was shrouded in secrecy. You know, we heard from students, you know, really mystifying disciplinary proceedings where they were shut out of the process. They filed a complaint, but they didn't necessarily know what happened during the adjudicatory process. All they knew were the outcomes. Or we talked with students who were sort of, they believe, steered into confidential mediations with the accused student and their alleged perpetrator, where everything that was said was, you know, confidential and not to be used in any further judicial proceeding. And we also talked to students that, you know, submitted to policies that acted as gag orders, essentially, where they had to keep quiet about certain details of their cases.
Here's what I find interesting. You know, Kristen, as I'm listening to you, I'm thinking about all the, you know, page by page by page in this investigation where I was reading all this thinking, oh my gosh, why is all this happening? What's the law? What law protects the university? What law protects the students? And Paul, that's where I want to bring you in because, you know, administrators of these universities say, oh, we're just following the law. I mean, this is a privacy issue. Yet you've got students saying, no way. They just want to keep it a secret. And that's what they were telling me to do. What does, and you know, FERPA, the Family Educational Rights and Privacy Act, I know plays a part here. Explain how that kind of creates a gray area here for both victim and also university and its take.
Well, the universities are in a complicated position. They have this FERPA law that you've just cited to, which basically preserves confidentiality. That's the law that if you send your kid off to college and you want to see his report card, the parent